Hi, I'd like to welcome all the viewers from all around the world who are tuning in today. My name is Mark Alfano, and I'm bringing you a special message. It's going to be entitled, Has Anyone Ever Told You? Now, I'm actually going to be getting our text from John 3 and verse 16. So go with me in your Bibles. I use the King James Version. But while you're going there, I'm going to go ahead and say a quick prayer. So Father God, I pray that you bless everyone who's viewing today, Lord. God, I pray you anoint my tongue to speak, and I pray that you anoint their ears to hear and receive, God. I pray that their spirits will be receptive, and whether it's today or 5 years from now, that somebody will be touched by this message, this powerful message. So hopefully you're with me in the Bible, to John 3 and verse 16, and it reads, For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Those 25 words, if you let them, will change your life. A lot of times people think, how can God send his only Son to die for me because I'm such a sinner? I've done so many things wrong in my life that he can't forgive me. Well, there's some good news and there's some bad news. The good news is, and the bad news is that we're all sinners, okay? If you look right now in Romans 3 and verse 23, it says, For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Of course we're all sinners. It's in our nature. It's in our DNA. Because Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden. They ate the forbidden fruit, which actually put that death and that sin into our DNA, which is passed down from generation to generation. Now, somebody could ask you, how can a child be in sin? Well, if the sin is now in the DNA and it comes through the bloodline, we see in Psalms 51 in verse 5 where it says, Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. So we can see there plainly that we're born into sin. The fact is, it's very apparent. And if you are a parent, you would know that even little children have a tendency to sin. I know I have a son who's 6 years old. He's a great kid. But there's times where he'll do something wrong and I'll say, Hey, did you do that? And I'll know that he did it. And he'll say, No, I didn't do it. And they do that because they don't want to get in trouble, right? But even if he didn't lie and even if he didn't do anything wrong, he is still a sinner because he was born with a sin nature that was passed down from the fall of man. Now, the fact is we're all born into sin. So, one thing you have to realize is, though, is that there's no sin that's too great to be covered by that John 3:16 verse, right? There's no sin that's too great, but there's also no sin that's too small that kind of disqualifies you either, right? So you may say, I just told a little white lie. Well, there's no such thing as a little white lie. A sin is a sin. Like I said, even if he never did anything wrong, because of that sin nature, because of that DNA, he has to pay the penalty. And the penalty, of course, is death. And we see that in Romans 6 and verse 23. It says, For the wages of sin is death. When Adam and Eve sinned, death came into the world. Now listen, there are three different types of death. So I've heard people say, and I know myself, I used to say, well, when I was younger, I say, well, Adam ate the forbidden fruit and they didn't die, right? Well, they actually did, because there's three different types of death. Okay, there's the first death that we go through, and that is the physical death. That's a death that basically all of us will face at some point, the end of our life. We go through a physical death. There's also a spiritual death. Now that is where we have a separation. We're alive in our body, but we're dead in our spirit. We're separated from God. And the third is called the eternal death. And that's where you're actually dead in your physical body and you're dead in your spiritual body, which is something you never want to experience, because if you're at that point, then you're in hell. Okay, so we don't want to have anyone experience that. Now, in Hebrews 9 and verse 27, it says, It is appointed man unto man once to die and then to go to the judgment. You can read Genesis, like I said, and you could say, hey, but they didn't die. But they did, because number one is Adam was designed to live forever. So he did live a long time because his body was designed to live forever. But he was immediately cut off from God. He used to walk with God in the morning. He used to spend a lot of quality time with God himself. And then he was thrown out and separated from God. So he had a spiritual death immediately. In our life, we see people who are physically alive, but they're spiritually dead. You could be standing right next to someone, literally an inch away from them, and be light years apart in the spirit realm. Okay, because they're unregenerated, their spirit's dead, but they're walking and talking, and they're alive, so they haven't been regenerated. Now, we also have had experiences where a believer passes away, but there's joy and there's rejoicing, because even though their body is dead, we know that their spirit is alive. We just lost the great Reinhard Bonnke. He has stepped out of his physical body, but his spirit continues on into glory, and we can celebrate. So we've been in funerals like that, and it's a celebration as opposed to a somber occasion. So no matter what, every one of us has to pay the price of the wage of sin, okay? So as you see, though, in John 3:16, Jesus came to die in our place. So somebody had to pay the price no matter what. So what Jesus did was say, no, don't worry about it. I'm going to take the death. I'm going to go into hell, and I'm going to take your place. And then obviously he defeated Satan, took the keys to hell. So now we can have the victory, right? But God gave us the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ. Through that action, now we have the gift of eternal life. Now, when Jesus died on the cross, it actually reversed the curse that came in when Adam and Eve, when they sinned, and now we have everlasting life. But you may ask, how does that reverse the curse? I'm going to read to you here in Genesis 3. 14 through 24. See, God had a plan. Immediately, once sin entered into the world, God had already had a redemption plan in place. In 3 and 14, it says, "And the Lord God said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle, above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly thou shalt go, and the dust thou shalt eat all thy days." Now, pay attention here in verse 15, because it says, "And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head," and then it says here, "and thou shalt bruise his heel." What are we talking about here? We're talking about the cross, right? So God already had this plan. God already had a redemption plan in order. Now, I love the Christmas season. It's such an amazing time of year. It's what we're getting ready to go into here. And just the other day, we had some pictures taken, family pictures with my wife and our six-year-old son, Gianni. And it was pretty neat because they had this whole setup with a fake Christmas tree and all the screen they pull. And in it, there was also a bunch of fake presents laying around. And my son really wanted to open the present. And what we told him was, we're like, listen, you can't open that present because it's not real. And he's like, why would anybody make a fake present? That doesn't even make sense, right? Well, what we need to realize is God has the perfect gift for us, and it's not a fake present. But the thing is we have to receive it. Now, there's a few things that you have to do. In Romans 10 and 13, it says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." And in John 3:16, once again, it says that, the second half of that says that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So we need to call on his name, number one. Number two, you have to believe in him. You have to believe in your heart that Jesus died for your sins. Jesus is the perfect gift. So we can put away all those counterfeit gifts that are out there. There's only one thing that'll fill that void in your life. And that's the love of Jesus and the fact that if you can have salvation, you can have that eternal life. So, Father God, I pray you bless the viewers today with long and healthy lives. And Jesus, do a quick work in their heart. If they have not received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, I would pray that they would do so now. So, viewers, everyone out there, if you'd like to have the free gift, the real gift that God has for you today, I want you to repeat after me, say it out loud, but then mean it in your heart. Say, "Dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sin. Wash me, cleanse me, set me free. Jesus, thank you that you died for me. I believe that you've risen from the dead and you're coming back for me. Fill me with your Holy Spirit. Give me a passion for the lost a hunger for the things of God, and a holy boldness to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. I am saved. I'm forgiven. I'm born again. And I'm on my way to heaven because I have Jesus in my heart. Now listen, as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, I tell you today that all of your sins are forgiven. Always remember to run to God, not from God, because He loves you and He has a wonderful plan for your life. Have you said that prayer? Please put a little note in the comments and just let us know. Okay, God bless.